Hear the best of TNCRadio.live every night. It's TNC Radio Primetime. Interviews, music, information, and news you can use every night. 7 to 9 Eastern, 6 to 8 Central, TNC Radio Primetime.
Yeah, welcome in TNCRadio.live, and we're live on a Wednesday night, May the 10th, 2023, and this is Taillights with the Baums, and now here's your host, Angie Baum.
Welcome back, everybody. So tonight I've got a couple guests with me. I have got Scott with me, who is Lisa's husband. I have Dennis, who is Candace's husband, and I have our good friend Matt. And we're just going to be talking tonight all about old school trucking. So, Scott, I think I'll let you go first if you want to kind of introduce yourself and tell everybody a little bit about yourself.
I'm Scott Trout, married to Lisa. Been trucking, legally 35 years. we've pretty much hauled it all. The wife spends a lot of time in the truck and at home, and that's about it. Just pretty much right now running the Midwest and trying to get seed corn done and start returns next week.
Yeah, you're pretty busy right now.
Yeah.
Dennis, I want to welcome you into the show as well. Dennis, you want to tell everybody a little bit about you and kind of, you know, let the audience get to know you a little bit better?
Yeah, I'm Dennis Hackler. I'm Candace's fiance. We've been together for about almost 5 years. I've been driving for 23 years. I'm in the flatbed industry. I've been doing that for about 9 years. That's about it. I mean, ain't much to say about me. I'm pretty easy peasy.
You've been my go-to guy since we started going to flatbed. Every time I've had questions, I'm like, hey, Candace, ask Dennis, because we're new to flatbed. It actually took us an hour today to do our first load, but hey, we got it done, so, you know, that's good.
Hey, don't feel bad. Today was a bad day for me, too, with that tarp. I mean, coming down the road, we ain't got blankets. I got to get some, and my tarp ripped all the way across, and now my coil's showing, and yeah.
Oh, no, that's never good.
No.
Matt, I'm going to let you come in and introduce yourself and tell everybody a little bit about you.
So I am Matt Neath. I'm an owner-operator. I've been flatbed for a little while now. Prior to that, I did a lot of livestock. I'm over the road. I'm married to an amazing woman that I've been with for 18 years. And that's basically about it. I spend a majority of my life in my truck. And when I'm lucky enough, I get to bring my amazing wife with me, and we have a great time together.
Oh, that's awesome. I always love it. Like, I know Candace rides with Dennis full-time, and I know Lisa goes out part-time. So it's always great when I hear truckers say, you know, I love it when I get to bring my wife out with me.
Yeah, you know, my wife and I have some of the best times I've had in trucking are with my wife. You know, because I've got to experience, as most of us have, you know, we've got to experience going across the country and seeing all the things. But then when I get to bring my wife with me and she gets to see the new places, it's almost like being able to see it all over again for the first time. So it's really fun.
No, I can imagine. Okay, so I have a question for you guys, and I guess we'll start with Scott, and we'll just kind of go round robin on that one. So, Scott, because I know all you guys have been in the trucking industry for a super long time, and things have changed so much over time. But what is, like, when you guys were first starting out trucking, what's the one thing that you guys miss the most that you wish things were the way it was back when you guys first started trucking?
Probably everybody helping everybody else. You just, you don't, You don't see it no more. I mean, even like when we hauled livestock, I mean, us older guys, you know, if somebody was having a problem, you know, we'd help each other. But you got these young kids coming in that think they know everything and they can do it all. And, you know, if you pull up beside somebody loading and, you know, they give you that kind of attitude, you just sit back and just watch them just struggle. I mean, I don't know. Things have changed so much in the whole trucking altogether that it seems like every year it just keeps getting worse.
I know. Larry and I talk about that all the time. I'm like, I think technology has really, you know, made it so much worse because everybody's so into their phones that, you know, people don't even communicate with each other in the truck stops.
Well, that's the whole thing too. You know, you go into the truck stop anymore, you know, people used to, you know, sit around, talk to each other. You walk into there anymore and everybody's sitting, you know, at separate tables and nobody talks to nobody. And, you know, it's not there no more.
I totally agree. Dennis, what's the one thing that you missed from when you first started trucking that you wish was different?
Well, I can totally agree with Scott. I mean, back in the day, it used to be like that where, you know, you helped each other out. Like, you know, the other day, there was an older guy getting loaded or unloaded where I was, and I was unloading myself. And, you know, he was an older feller, and I kind of got out there and started talking to him. And, you know, we chit-chat and helped him with pull this tarp and stuff. And he said, you know, you don't have that anymore. And, you know, another thing that you don't hear anymore is people talking on the CB radios. I mean, it's nothing anymore. You can sit there for miles going down the road and holler at somebody and you don't get nothing back. Or if you do, you hear somebody bicking and fighting. And, you know, it's just like, why even leave the radio on anymore? I mean, you know, you don't talk to nobody. It used to be you can go down the road and just have a conversation with somebody.
Yeah, that's the one thing Larry misses, because that's what he said. He goes, when I started out trucking, he goes, you know, if I was tired in the middle of the night, he goes, I just got on the CB radio and, you know, said, hey, I'm tired, I need somebody to talk to. And he goes, before you knew it, you had three or four truckers talking to you.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that's the one thing I miss. I mean, it used to be, you know, you could holler on the radio and be like, hey, is the chicken house open? And people would be like, yeah, it's open. Or you got a smoky bear sitting in the middle or full grown. I mean, you just don't get that anymore. And, you know, people, you know, nowadays too, when you flash them to get over whatever, and they don't even say thank you anymore. They just keep going.
Oh, that's my biggest pet peeve. I hate that. So for those of you guys that may not know it, if you're, you know, not a truck driver, but we have lights on our truck and trailer. And so the lights in the front, we can flash to tell, you know, to tell somebody that it's safe for them to get over. And then we also have lights in the back to thank a trucker. And it bugs me to no end when you, you know, thank a trucker and you don't get the thank you back. I'm like, it takes you 2 seconds to press a button just to say thank you or you're welcome, you know?
Exactly. Like mine's on the blinker and all I do is push a button in and, you know, it flashes and boom, you know, thanks for letting me over, but you just don't get that anymore.
No. Matt, what's the one thing that you wish it was different from when you started driving?
I also agree with Scott and Dennis on that. You know, the camaraderie of trucking is pretty much gone now, you know, and the big thing, one of the things that I miss, I think the most, is now we're seeing a lot of the older drivers getting out and being able to have a conversation with a veteran driver, especially when you're a newbie, you know, being able to come in and just talk to veteran drivers and just pick their brain, you know, and they were always willing to you could have a 2 hour long conversation out of just picking a veteran's brain, and you don't get that anymore. You know, nobody helps anybody anymore. And, you know, if you want advice from somebody, it's just not really there anymore. And it's a shame because you can learn so much from just picking one old veteran driver's brain a little bit. You know, I mean, they've been there, they've done that. and they can teach you so much. And it's sad to me that I get it. The older truckers got to step out and retire, but it's a shame that the new generation of truckers isn't learning how to pass that knowledge on.
That is so true. And that was actually my next question I was going to get. So we're going to take a quick break, but when we come back, that was my next question for you guys is, what was one piece of advice that you've gotten from a mentor that you could share with everybody? So we're going to take just a quick break. And when we come back, we'll be back with Scott, Dennis, and Matt. You're listening to Taillights with the Baums.
This info blog on TNCRadio.live is brought to you by the Truckers Network at app.thetruckersnetwork.net. ISS score for truck drivers explained and how to find it. An inspection selection system score is called ISS score was created by the Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration, FMCSA, to help law enforcement officers determine if the truck should be inspected. The inspection selection system score is frequently used to determine if your truck will receive a bypass command or not. There is often confusion between the ISS score and the CSA score. While there's a correlation between the two, they're not the same thing. The CSA score identifies high-risk motor carriers. The score is based on the performance data of the driver. The ISS score uses a combination of different CSA categories known as Behavior Analysis and Safety Improvement Category. That's BASICS for short, to determine the carrier's overall inspection rating from 0 to 100. Similar to the CSA score, the lower, the better. What determines your ISS inspection value? Unsafe driving, hours of service, HOS, driver fitness, controlled substances and alcohol, vehicle maintenance and cargo, hazardous material. There are three different ISS ratings categories: inspect, optional, or pass. Inspect, 75 to 100. Optional, 50 to 74. Pass, 1 to 49. ISS scores can determine how often you'll get inspected. Although some roadside inspections are at random times, most will be as a result of a higher ISS score. How to find ISS score. The FMCSA has an online portal where carriers can log in to check their ISS scores. You'll log in using your DOT-issued PIN. From there, you'll see the company information section on the main screen. Next, click the blue button labeled Inspection Selection System Info. This info blog was brought to you by the Truckers Network at app.thetruckersnetwork.net.
At Hot Shot Secret, we share the science behind common diesel problems and their solutions. For example,
diesel particulate filter regeneration.
The DPF catches particulates left over from combustion. The DPF regeneration cycle cleans the filter with temperatures exceeding 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit. A computer sensor triggers the DPF regen, which is often accompanied by a loss of power and fuel economy. The frequency of DPF regens are in correlation to the cleanliness of the fuel burn. Under heavy operation with a dirty burn, DPF regens can occur multiple times per day. Hotshot Secret Diesel Extreme Fuel Additive promotes a more complete combustion, creating fewer emissions and therefore fewer DPF regens. Vehicles using Diesel Extreme experience 83% less DPF regens.
Hotshot Secret Diesel Extreme is available nationwide at truck stops, fine farm and auto stores, and online at hotshotsecret.com.
Hotshot Secret, powered by science.
You're listening to TNCRadio.live. Remember to tune into the Truckers Network radio show with Shelley Johnson weekdays at 3 p.m. Central, 4 p.m. Eastern.
Welcome back, everybody. You are listening to Taillights with the Baums, and I'm your host, Angie. And we have been talking with Scott, Dennis, and Matt. We've been talking a little bit about old school trucking tonight. And before we went to break, we were kind of talking about, Matt, you had brought up a really good point about how, you know, it's nice to be able to talk to those old timers and get those advice. And that was actually one of my questions I had for you guys. And so I'll start with Scott. Scott, what was one piece of advice that you can remember or something that was like, you know, really stood out to you that an old timer gave you? Because I know we've all had those moments.
I guess the biggest thing, well, I've been around livestock all my life. The thing, you know, I guess the thing I got drilled in my head, like when I was really, really young, that patience. I mean, you know, they're animals, you know, they just have patience. I mean, when we started hauling pigs and stuff, and you just, from cattle to pigs, you got to have more patience. And you see a lot of these younger drivers come in, and they just don't have the patience. And, you know, if they can't get, you know, an animal to do what they want, they will just get mad and they'll start throwing things. And I've seen a lot of people get kicked out of plants and barns, and just because they just lose their temper and just go off. And I guess, you know, when I was young, I mean, I got it drilled in my head that, you know, you just take your time and just, you know, it's all about patience with animals.
Oh, yeah, especially with what you do, which is not easy, because you've got the stress of trying to make sure you get those animals to their location safely. But then, like you said, when they're not wanting to cooperate, it can be frustrating.
Yeah, we've had, I mean, I think like when we started doing breeding hogs, that really tried your patience, because with breeding stock, you got everybody watching you. There's cameras everywhere. The level of stress is a lot higher, and you got the farmers watching you, and you got, you know, the breeders watching you, you know, the vets are watching you. I mean, you got everybody watching what you're doing, you know, and, you know, you start losing your temper. Yeah, it's a good way to lose your job real quick. You there, Ann?
Yep, sorry about that. I lost connection there for a second. So, Matt, I was going to go to you next and let you answer that too. But I was going to say real quick, Scott, when you were talking, and you were talking about how you were patience, and that was a good one for us, because today was our first flatbed load. And that's the one thing that Larry has always, from day one, because he was my trainer. And so he's always been like, you know, don't care about what other people say. Nobody's going to rush us. And that's how he was today, because we were like freaking out. We're like, we're taking forever and they're waiting on us. And he's like, nope. He's like, let them wait.
No.
And everything worked out better.
just take your time. Make sure everything's right. And if people got to wait, they got to wait. You know, if the thing of it is, you know, if they see you having a problem, you know, it ain't like it used to be somebody would come up and help you. I mean, we used to do steel out of Nucor in Norfolk, and it used to be, you know, somebody's having problems, somebody come up, help you anymore. They'll just look at you and sit in their truck and, you know, just give you dirty looks. Or I don't know. Things have changed so much since we started.
It actually worked up really good, because there was another flatbed couple that they got done way before us, and they saw us struggling. And so they came over, they're like, do you guys need some help? And so then we told them, well, this is our first flatbed load. And they're like, oh, well, crap, let's come over here and show you some tips. And so I was like, we kind of like took a big sigh. We're like, oh, thank God, somebody's helping us. So it worked out good.
Yeah.
And on that note, I will also say, I have found that other than livestock, the flatbed community is one of the most helpful communities as far as trucking goes.
That is good to know, because I tell you what, the people that we met today were awesome, and they give us some really good pointers, and they were so cool once they realized that this was our first load. We'd never done it before, so it was helpful. Well, Dennis, I'm going to let you answer that same question too. Have you ever had a mentor that said something to you that was really stood out in your mind?
Well, I do have to agree with Scott. I mean, the patience did carry over with his marriage, so we got that. Yeah, I mean, my mentor, you know, he taught me a lot, you know, how to read a map, which you don't have anymore. You know, go through routes, look for low clearances, stuff like that. And anymore, it's just all GPS. Nobody even knows how to even read a map, especially this new school age. If you gave them a map, they'd be like, what do you want me to do with this?
Yeah, I'm really surprised they don't teach that in CDL school. because everybody's so reliant on their GPSs.
Exactly. There's times that my GPS, you know, wants to take me down a road, and I'm like, no, I'm not going down that road. I'm not even going to fit down that road. And, you know, you can't rely on the GPS. I mean, I still got to look at a map every now and then to see the routes that I need to take.
Absolutely. Well, Matt, did you have a mentor that stood out in your mind or someone that gave you some good advice along the way?
The one thing that stood out to me, and it may not be the most positive piece of advice, but it was a piece of advice that just kind of stuck with me, and that is this day and age, everything as a truck driver and as being in a rig out on the road, everything is our fault, and we are nothing more than a rolling lawsuit to 90% of the population. So that always kind of is in the back of my head, as I always have my head on a swivel and I'm watching everything, obviously, that's going on around me, because this day and age, people brake check you on purpose. People Yep. cut in front of you on purpose, hoping that you'll hit them. And so when I got that piece of advice, and that was when I first came into being an owner operator, you know, I had another older gentleman that had been an owner operator for years. He was actually getting ready to retire, and he told me that. And it's always just kind of stuck with me. Like I said, it might not be the most positive piece of advice, but it's true, and it's always stuck with me.
It is true, and it's sad. I mean, when you look at the statistics of how many drivers, when they do have an accident, you know, majority of the time, and I would say it's probably 90% or above, it's the driver's the one that has the blame. You know, the driver's the one, even if he got brake checked, you know, we see it all the time. And so you're absolutely right.
You know, and a good example that really holds that piece of advice true is I challenge a lot of drivers out there, whether you're in a truck or you're in a four-wheeler, when you're driving down the interstate, watch the billboards and count how many billboards you see that are attorney-based billboards that say, hit by a truck, injured by a truck driver, mm-hmm. call us.
Mm-hmm. I was just going to say the exact same thing. You are so right. And you're seeing more and more of them these days. Yeah, you are absolutely right. They're all over the place, and we hear about it all the time where, you know, they have little schemes where they try to brake check you simply for the insurance money.
And that's where, like, technology, I think, is useful and it's in those situations where dash cams are a necessity these days.
I agree. What'd you say, Dennis? I'm sorry.
I can agree with that. My company's got dash cams facing forward and at the driver. So, you know, somebody can't sit there and say, hey, he's playing on the phone and he hit me. So.
Yeah, and they're so inexpensive these days. It's almost foolish not to have one. I mean, that is like, that's protecting our butts. And you know, even the GPSs now, a lot of them have them. So it's definitely worth the investment.
Yes, definitely.
We're going to take another quick break. When we come back with the guys, we're going to talk to them and see if any of them have had any close calls during their trekking career. So we'll be back in just a few minutes. You are listening to Taillights with the Baums.
Be sure to listen to Building Strong Minds with Dr. Chris, Mondays at 7 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Central, right here on TNCRadio.live.
Hi, I'm Dr. Christopher Cortman, and now for the Mental Health Minute. In the last video, we were talking about Hans Selye at the University of Montreal and how he discovered this general adaptation syndrome, which has three different distinct stages. The first stage, the alarm reaction, And we were built for this alarm reaction, this fight or flight. We can do this many times throughout our lives and never have it be a big issue. The problem is when the perceived threat, the stressor, stays with us. And then we go into a second stage called resistance. In resistance, we're fighting that stressor in high gear. We continue to fight and fight and fight to protect our system from some type of perceived stressor. Like what? Well, sometimes we have chronic financial problems. We're underemployed, or the bills just keep coming in and we don't have enough to pay them off. And sometimes we have a high conflict relationship or high conflict marriage that ends up a high conflict divorce. Or sometimes we have a sick child or some type of illness in the family that we can't get an accurate diagnosis, let alone successful treatment. Whatever it is, the stressor continues, and we continue to resist that in the second stage, which leads to a third stage, which is exhaustion. And according to Selye, that's when we break down. We have our depressive episodes, or we begin to be dominated by an anxiety disorder, or sometimes we have these psychophysiological symptoms like migraine headaches, or we even have issues that are require years of stress, like Parkinson's disease. We have things that are caused by the wear and tear of the body over time. That's the third stage of stress, exhaustion. Now, this logically leads to a fourth stage, which is disease, and then a fifth stage, which is death. Stress over a long period of time ages us, breaks us down, and leads us to death. I'll talk to you in the next video on how we could avoid that.
Kathy DeCaro is nothing short of amazing. She not only drives the world's biggest truck as a heavy equipment operator in northern Alberta, Canada. She's an international motivational speaker and the author of Dream Big, an autobiography about overcoming a lifetime of trauma and abuse that led to dreams of success. Kathy inspires people the world over to change their lives and improve their self-worth. Her book will change your life. She's passionate about personal growth and believes anyone can change their circumstances and overcome their obstacles if they believe in themselves. Her life will amaze you and seriously inspire you. Be sure to order a copy of her book, Dream Big, on Amazon.com. Don't forget, you can hear all of our TNC Radio primetime shows again on our podcasts. Just go to tncradio.live/podcasts or search for tncradio.live wherever you listen to podcasts.
Welcome back, everybody. You are listening to Taillights with the Baums. I'm your host, Angie, and we've been talking with Scott, Dennis, and Matt tonight. We've been talking a little bit about old school trekking because these guys have been trekking for a real long time. And before the break, I brought up the question. I'm sure as long as you guys have been driving that we've probably all had, you know, a near miss or a close call, or maybe you've had an accident. But we'll start with Scott, and we'll go round robin again. Have you guys ever had a close call?
Yeah. Too many times to count. I. Do you want the worst one or?
Whichever one stands out in your mind the most.
probably when we lost our truck and trailer. That was probably our worst one. I was coming home from Colorado out by Colby, Kansas, and I had my cattle pot that was totally boarded up because I took baby pigs out to Colorado, and I was trying to get home, and it was windy. I mean, it was pretty windy, and they were closing down. They had the interstate closed down, so I was like, well, I'll just take back roads up toward McCook and come across that way, and I come out from back behind it. Well, I was coming down the highway, and I was coming out from the edge of town, and there was a big elevator on the edge of town, and I broke the edge of the elevator. The trailer went in the air. The drives went in the air. The only thing that was still on the ground was my steer tires, and thank God when everything went in the air, I was doing only like 40 mile an hour, and by the time I got slowed down and I rolled into the ditch, my steer tires were the only ones on the ground. And when it flopped over, I was pretty much stopped when it went down.
I bet you that was incredibly scary. And I know, because I know your wife, Lisa, and I've talked to her about this particular accident. And I know how scared she was because she wasn't with you. And so she was scared. Yeah.
Well, the bad thing of it is when the truck went down, it went down on the passenger side. So if she'd have been on that side, you know, she would have took the whole impact of the whole truck flopping down.
Wow. So, thank God you were okay. That's the important thing.
Well, the thing of it is everything happened so slow that I knew it was going, because we've been out in western Nebraska, I don't know how many times, and trailer's been in the air. And, you know, we'd be driving down the road and, you know, I'd ask her, you know, look out the window, what lane the trailer's in. She goes, oh, it's over in the shoulder. You know, the trailer be in the air, and you just, I don't know, if you're going to pull one of them trailers, you kind of just have no fear, I guess. I don't know. So
I don't know that I can do it.
I guess that's probably our worst one, because the old guys always told me it's not a matter of, you know,
when,
if it's going to happen, it's when it's going to happen. You know, you can't pull a trailer like that with holes in it with, you know, in the weather, because, you know, the thing of it is when you haul livestock, you got to go no matter what. It doesn't matter if it's raining, snowing, ice, it don't matter. You got to go. So it's just, you know, I guess you just got to have no fear, I guess. I mean, that's a lot of it. You that are stupid, one of the two.
Okay, I'm glad you said that. No, I'm just kidding.
No, she's sitting there pointing her finger at me. Yeah, that's you.
I knew she was.
Yeah.
Okay, Dennis, have you ever had a close call?
Well, I've had several, like you said, quite a few in my life. But I got to say, the worst one that I've had was down there in Texas, and I believe it was on 10. You know, traffic moving 75 mile an hour, 80. And all of a sudden, everybody just slams on their brakes for no reason. Well, I got to slam on mine, and I'm not stopping. Like, my brakes completely failed when I slammed on them. So I ended up having to hit the median, and I was loaded with, you know, 45,000 pounds of steel. And to this day, I thank God that my trailer never overturned, because, you know, it was bad. I mean, the median I hit was slanted. So when I hit it, I rode it out for about 200 yards, and then I was finally able to come back up on the road. But I know for a fact to this day, if I wouldn't have done that, I'd have probably killed 3 or 4 people easy. And, you know, after I come back up on the road, I had people going by me giving me thumbs up like, thanks. So never figured out why the traffic just stops for no reason. But it was just like everybody hit the brakes, all 5 lanes.
Oh, I think that's the scariest. That, to me, when you're coming up, you know, especially if you're like coming up over a hill and all of a sudden you come across and everybody stopped. And then the other thing that still scares me this day is like when I'm in Wyoming and you get those really high winds and then just like a gust of wind comes out of nowhere. still to this day, I'm just like, oh my gosh, it scares the crap out of me.
Yeah, I've been in Nebraska when the tornadoes touched down across the fields. And it was pretty fun, but I mean, I got next to another truck and we rode it out together, but that was another close one, was that tornado. But other than that, I'd say that Texas one was the worst that I've ever encountered.
Wow. Okay, Matt, you got a close call?
Again, yeah, several. there's two of them that really stand out to me. One was back in my grain hauling days. It was in middle of January, and I live in Iowa, and we were hauling grain up to Cedar Rapids, and I had left the grain facility, so I was empty. And if anybody knows, those grain wagons don't weigh anything. And I was coming out, and I was on 380, and I had a lady and a four-wheeler cut down in front of me and then slam on her brakes. Well, I had to hit my brakes, and it was slick. And if you know 380 in that area, there's a big curve on that road going through Cedar Rapids. I'm sure Scott knows.
Yeah. What I'm talking about.
So I was in the middle of that curve when she slammed on her brakes, and I had to hit my brakes. Well, I look at my passenger mirror, and I'm jackknifing. I see my trailer coming around. I'm like, oh no, what do I do? So I rode it out. I dropped my truck down into the bottom lane. My trailer was taking up the other two lanes, and I just put it to the floor and hoped for the best. And luckily enough, my trailer straightened out, and I rode it out, and nothing bad happened. But it was definitely a pucker moment.
I think that's like my worst. That's the one thing I've always been worried about, is jackknifing. So yeah, I couldn't even imagine like looking in my passenger window and seeing my trailer right there. Like, oh gosh.
The other little one that I had was when I was hauling livestock, and me and a buddy were just leaving out. We were heading across, going over to Western Iowa. We were on Highway 92, and it just started downpouring. And then it started hailing, and the wind picked up, straight line winds. And we were nose to tail with each other at about 20 mile an hour, and our trailers were lifting off the ground. And that was another pucker moment.
Oh my goodness. Yeah. That's the thing. I don't think people realize, you know, how many close calls we as truckers have out here. And a lot of times, you know, it's either weather related, or a lot of times it's, you know, related to four wheelers either cutting us off or brake checking us, or, you know. So when one of you guys was talking about having to keep your head on a swivel, and it's true, we're constantly having to watch our surroundings at all times. You have to drive very defensively out here.
And I think people don't realize, you know, they think that all we do is just sit in a truck all day. You know, oh, that's not hard work. But the amount of stress that we deal with on a daily basis is more tiring than, I think, working a physical job for 8 hours.
I completely agree with you. I think that is so true. I think it. By the time you get done with your shift, you are absolutely exhausted. We're going to take another break, and when we come back, we'll be talking with Scott, Dennis, and Matt. But we're going to be talking, we also see a lot of funny things out here over the road. And so when we come back, I'm going to ask you guys, what's the funniest thing that you guys have ever seen out here? You're listening to Tail Lights with the Baums.
Frontlane introduces Impulse, the world's first collision alert system for the driver behind you when you have to brake hard. Impulse uses ultra-bright pulsing red LEDs to alert drivers behind you who might not be giving their full attention to the road. Using amazing accelerometer technology and a battery that will last for years, Impulse installs in minutes, fits nearly any vehicle, and never requires additional wiring. Drivers react 50% faster, helping to protect you and your passengers. Learn more by visiting www.frontlane.com/impulse. That's www.frontlane.com/impulse. Approved by all 50 states. Impulse by Frontlane.
Finding a safe place to park your rig at night can be a challenge on the road. The Truckers Network, a membership resource site for trucking companies, company drivers, and owner-operators, proudly partners with Truck Park to offer safe and secure overnight truck parking to all Truckers Network members. Truck Park is the digital truck parking leader and America's fastest-growing truck parking service. The Truckers Network exists to link truck drivers with the best quality trucking products and services the industry has to offer. Finding safe overnight parking is crucial for truck drivers, and many drivers struggle with finding available parking spots. The limited parking availability causes drivers to lose sleep, which poses a safety risk to others on the road. Safe parking is valuable for drivers and the cargo they're transporting. With this partnership, Truckers Network members will have access to a discount code and be able to reserve parking spots in real time along their truck route at a reduced price. Truck Park gives drivers access to parking locations across most of the United States. Simply enter the city and state to view available parking spaces nearest a pickup or delivery point, then pay to reserve. Parking rates vary at each location, with some rates as low as $10. Truck Park is a values-based company that empowers truck drivers while providing a safe and unmatched experience. The company offers a quick way to find and reserve parking spots throughout the U.S. Truck drivers have access to Truck Park's free mobile app to easily begin reserving parking spots based on their truck route. About the Truckers Network. The Truckers Network exists to link truckers and trucking businesses throughout the United States. The company's mission is to make the life of a truck driver easier by connecting drivers to the highest quality trucking products and services to keep their trucks on the road.
Hello, I'm Rod Samuels. I put it in reverse gear Monday through Thursday nights at 10, 9 Central on TNCRadio.live. We know that life as a driver is not easy. Between four-wheelers and Mother Nature, sometimes life throws us curves like no one else. Quite often we need help from the good Lord just to make it through the day. When you do, dial the TFC Global 24-Hour Prayer Line. It's 866-515-9406. Now, if you're using the TNCRadio.live app, just press the Prayer Line button to be connected with a prayer warrior who'll confidentially pray with and for you. The number again, 866-515-9406, or tap the Prayer Line button at the TNCRadio.live app.
You're listening to TNCRadio.live. Remember to tune in to the Truckers Network Radio Show with Shelly Johnson weekdays at 3 p.m. Central, 4 p.m. Eastern.
Welcome back, everybody. You are listening to Tail Lights with the Baums, and I'm your host, Angie. I just want to give all my truckers a quick reminder that next week we do have the DOT Blitz going on. This is going to be going on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. The two things that they're going to be looking for this year is anti-lock braking systems, so your ABS, and also cargo securement. So just be watching. You're probably going to see a lot of bears out there. Okay, guys, before we went to break, I said, you know, we see a lot of bad things out here on the road, but I know we also see a lot of funny things. So I figure we kind of go round robin again, and maybe you guys can share some funny things you guys have seen out there on the road. We'll start with Scott.
No, that wasn't probably my hood.
Oh, okay.
The wife, she wasn't with me. I was down by Talladega, and I I was going out to a farm to load early in the morning. There was storm the night before, and I was going down this little itty bitty two lane road. It was by a national forest or something, and there was quite a bit of traffic. It was kind of like 7 o'clock in the morning, and I was going south toward this farm, and I was coming up this hill, and I saw something in the road. I didn't know for sure what it was, and there was cars coming the other way, and I topped the hill, and there was half a tree laying in my lane. And it was like, well, it's either go in the other lane, go in the ditch, which I looked and I could not see the bottom, so that wasn't an option, or hit the tree. I smacked the tree. It put a 6-inch gash, well, slice, in my hood from my radiator all the way back to my firewall. And I found a place for pullover. I looked at it. It didn't hurt nothing in the motor or my air cleaners or nothing. And I was supposed to be loading that morning. So I was like, well, nothing's hurt. I'm going to run it. So I went down. And, of course, I got to the farm, and he looked up my hood, and he goes, what happened? I said, well, I said, hit a tree on the way down here. He goes, you going to be able to load and get home? I said, yep. I said, it'll work. So he kind of laughed and goes, all right. He goes, I trust you. So I loaded, and I had to go back to the truck stop and to weigh to leave. And I pulled in the truck stop, and yep, I heard it. The minute I pulled in the truck stop, everybody was coming over and looking at my hood. You know, I asked them what happened. Like, well, hit a tree. And I mean, it put a 6-inch gash from my radiator all the way to the firewall. I mean, all the way through, and I drove 1,200 miles loaded with cattle all the way up to Nebraska with a big hole all the way through the side of my hood.
Thank you. Oh, my goodness.
And I had the radio, I had the CB on the whole time, and I heard it 1,200 miles.
You know you got a hole in your hood?
Yeah, I know. It's like, and I kept telling everybody, it's like, it's better aerodynamic that way. It just helps the airflow.
I did it on purpose.
Yeah, but when I got back home, I took it to the body shop. It that was not good. I mean, they wanted to total the truck out because when it hit the firewall, it mashed everything in, and it was quite a bit to get it fixed. I mean, it was an older truck, and it wasn't worth a lot, but it was our first truck, and we had it fixed and kept running it. But yeah, I got a lot of crap for that 1,200 miles coming home. But hey, I got the load home, so
yeah, it did what it needed to do.
I know, but I don't know. You see so many weird things. I mean, yeah. Well, the wife likes going through Roswell all the time and look all the freaks down there. I mean,
that's one place I haven't been through yet. I really want to go through Roswell.
I'm surprised with you guys doing military, and you guys have never been down there.
I know. I'm so disappointed. I really want to go. That's like the one place I have not been yet.
Yeah, because I'm surprised you guys haven't been in there before.
I know.
I've been in there
one time. Dennis, yeah. You got a funny story from the road?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I've got a bunch, but the one that stands out the most is with Candace. You know, first time she ever went to Florida, and we're driving down the road, and, you know, we're listening to the radio and everything, and all of a sudden, she jumps up in the seat, standing in the seat, pointing in a creek over off the interstate. Look, an alligator. I'm like, what is wrong with you? I mean, she's sitting there screaming, jumping up and down in the seat, and she was just amazed by that there's an alligator in a ditch. I'm like, good God, you about made me wreck. I thought something was wrong with you over there. I've never seen somebody get so excited.
Okay, that's funny as I'll get out, because that's exactly what I was doing last week when we were in Florida. I'm like, as many times as we've been in Florida, I do. I look in the dishes every time hoping I see an alligator, and I've never seen one.
Oh, she does. She does. She does that every time we go down there. She always looking in the dishes, and then when she does see one, she jumps up in the seat and screams, and, oh, my God, I need a picture.
See, that's
well, I'll be coming up there. Through. I'll be coming up through Alligator Alley on 75 on Friday, Candace, so I'll take pictures for her.
Oh, I want to see two. Matt, you got a funny story from the road?
So I do. I have what you would call a case of instant karma. So I was cruising through Indianapolis, and we all know how Indianapolis is on the 465. And I had this guy that was just being a complete jerk for no reason. And he would get in front of me, brake check me. I would try to switch lanes. He would switch in front of me, brake check me more. I did everything I could to get around this guy and just get away from him. And he just was relentless. I don't know what his problem was, but he had one. Well, this went on for, I don't know, probably a good 8 miles. And all of a sudden, I hear sirens, and up comes screaming up my right.
Wild thing, I think I love you.
A motorcycle cop. He'd sat back and watched, and he came screaming up and pulled that guy over right in front of me.
Oh, that's awesome.
It was just, to me, it was hilarious because I was like, ha, instant karma. And it was just, in that moment, it was hilarious. I mean, it was frustrating when the guy was doing it to me, but then when the cop come flying up, it was hilarious.
I do that all the time when somebody brake checks us or, you know, a truck's driving rashly. I'm like, where's a cop when you need one? So that's pretty cool that he pulled him over. That is instant karma. Well, I want to thank you guys so much for being on this show with me tonight. It's been a blast. But I do want to remind everybody that coming up next, we have Anderson and Baker with Clutch Time Sports. So if you are a sports fan, I highly recommend that you stick around. These guys are awesome. Larry and I listen to them every week. And I want to remind you also that coming up tomorrow night, 7 p.m. Central, I have my girls coming up, and they have their new show, In It for the Long Haul, at 7 p.m. Central. And as a reminder, me and the girls will be on 32 Truckers a Day on TikTok right after the show if you would like to come in and join us. And we'll be back here next Wednesday, and you can listen to Larry and I with Taillights with the Baums. But thanks again so much, guys, for being on here with us, and we'll definitely have to have you guys back.
It was definitely
thanks for having me.
Thanks, guys. Have a safe week, and we'll see you guys next Wednesday with Taillights with the Baums. Us.